1:5:1. Jesus is coming again. Once you have that and stand, I'll open up the word of prayer. Father, we thank you again for this evening you've given us. Thank you for the word of God. We ask now for your blessing, your guidance, your direction. I pray that your presence be evident. We ask now again that you be with us in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus is coming again. 151.
Yeah.
Sign up out here for We still have the sign up out here for our fellowship at the pastor's house. If you could, please sign up. Tonight I'll pull it up and that's what I'll get my count from. Also on Sunday we'll have a brief business meeting. Just 10 or 15 hours. That's about all. She didn't catch that right off. I could tell by looking her face. And remember, June 30th, we'll have birthdays, anniversaries observed after the morning service. And then we'll come back at 6 for the evening. Those who wish to help, if you could come a little early. I have noticed that we don't have the same amount of tables and chairs out there. I don't know that they won't bring more or whatever. But I would encourage you to probably think on that and maybe bring your own just in case. So we'll see what happens with that. There is a sign up for that. Be sure to bring a side. And as I said, if you care to come and volunteer to show up early, that would be great. I don't know how it's all going to go, but we'll wing it. Anyway, on the next song, 325. 325.
More of his meekness, more humility.
hearts, you may be seated. All right, we're in the book of Colossians. Colossians, and we have almost finished verse 7. I'm just going to do a little freshen up, a little refresh, or whatever you want to call it. And we was going through verse 7, said, "Rooted and built up in Him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving." If you understand the context of that, is verse 6, "As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in Him." So we're talking about rooted and built up in Him as in Christ Jesus. And so we have gotten down and we're talking about the part or the section there that says, "As ye have been taught." It speaks to how we are to be rooted and built up in our faith. It speaks to this is not necessarily talking about the teaching of men. If I say that, it kind of throws off. Just let me say it this way. I'm going to differentiate between the teaching of men and the teachings of the Word of God, the Bible. So when I say the teachings of men, I'm talking about those who are ungodly. They're not teaching correctly. They're teaching error. So this is, we're talking about if the person is a godly teacher and adhering to the Word of God, we can follow after them. And I think, but when you look at this, it says, "Rooted and built up in Him, established in the faith as you have been taught." I think we're going back to the teachings of the Word of God. Not necessarily men, but those men who have picked up the Word of God. They picked up the sword, they picked up the baton, if you would, and have continued what Christ has started, like Paul. As ye have been taught by Paul, you could easily say. It could be he's referencing that. But I want to go back and say we are to adhere to the teachings of the Word of God. If I teach error, you shouldn't be here. Okay? If I teach error, you shouldn't be here. If I teach one day, one Sunday, and I'm off a little bit, you know, that's fine. I remember a pastor had me stand up a verse was read, and then he wanted me to explain the verse out. I resisted greatly. Why? I had my thoughts on the verse, but I hadn't studied. So he forced me to. So I went ahead and said what I thought. Well, it just so happened I was preaching there the next Sunday. So I went home and studied the verse out. So when I come in that Sunday and I was supposed to preach, I apologized to the people. And then I told them, this is what it means. That's a bad situation to be put in, because you need to have time. You need to study. And I say that to say this. How would you know if I'm preaching error if you're not studying the Word of God? There's a great responsibility on churches today. And I'm afraid they're failing miserably. And that's, when I say churches, you understand I'm talking, the church is the people. And if they're failing to study the Word of God, if they're failing to do that, then they're failing miserably in their walk with God. And so as you have been taught, I assume that he is taking it, that these people are studying, these people understand, or maybe he's understanding with saying this with the understanding, as I have taught you. But you need to be careful. Not all people teach the Word of God as they should. You understanding, I'm putting the stress on the vital part of being taught, that we are taught according to the Word of God. This is it. I mean, they can wax elegant, they can do anything they want, but if it's in violation of the Word of God, it's worthless for eternal purposes. It's nothing. So with that said, it's important for each and every time of person to have time with God. You have to have your own time to be with God. I cannot Boy, let me put it this way, and hopefully you understand. I cannot make you spiritual. I cannot sit here and preach and teach and make you spiritual. It's impossible for me to do that. Because I can preach and teach and you can reject it. What you should be doing
if I preach and teach, it should, if there's sin in your life, bring you under conviction. But if you're going to have more progress in your Christian life if you spend time with God, I would advise every Christian to read so much in the Bible every morning, and I would advise you to pick a book. Start with a short, small book first. Get you a notebook. You start with verse 1, you write it out, and then you get you a concordance. With everybody having a computer, you can download a free a computer program on your phone. Doesn't cost you a thing. And take that verse and begin to think and meditate on it and break it down. If you do that, write out the truths that you get out from that verse. And if you make that your practice in devotional every day, you will grow. You pray and ask God, reveal some truths to me. Speak to me today, and God will begin to do a work in your life. See, that's the basics of what I do to prepare sermons and lessons. That's the very basics. You probably won't spend as much time as I do, but anything like that, going in there and searching out the Word of God, that's going to build you. It's going to build you more than just preaching will. This is where you take and you ingest. You know what preaching is for most people? Anybody? It's entertainment. Why do I say that?
It's not applied.
Well, you can just sit back. What is entertainment? See, you don't have to engage. This is an engagement time. I have two times that we engage. We engage Sunday morning in Sunday school, and we engage Wednesdays. And the reason for it, actually we do it in our teaching, but that's a little bit different context. But the reason for it is to get that thinking process going. Now, some days we come in here and you're like, and I know it's been a long, tough day. Everybody's ready to go home. You come here and you sacrifice, and I appreciate that. But you understand what I'm saying. You want to engage. You want to think. You want to meditate. You want to, what is the word, ruminate? Ruminate on the Word of God. Chew it up. I'll leave that out. I'm getting ready to. Anyway. So, you getting in the Word of God and doing that, who's teaching you then? Exactly. And the closer you are to Him, the more surrendered you are to Him, the more you'll get from Him. And so that's the key. We should be rejoicing, really, that we have the Word of God. We should rejoice every day. We should thank God that He has communicated with us. He has given us His Word in order that we might know Him, that we might know the power of His resurrection. And the question is, are we really rejoicing? Are we happy about that? I think a lot of times we're not. We see, God gave me His Word, now I got to read it. We do get that way. I see it all the time. We have a life. I felt that way before. So tired from work, not getting enough sleep. But when you have to get up in front of a crowd of people and preach, there is a motivating factor behind that. There's a big motivating factor behind that. And we need to be motivated. We need to rejoice. Have you ever thought about that sometime in the past there was someone who won somebody to the Lord, and that became your path of salvation? I'll explain. I see the look. Who led Spurgeon to the Lord? He may have only led one person, right? How many people, because of what Spurgeon has done, have come to know Christ? I praise the Lord for the people He's put in my life. Some of them I weren't very happy about at the time, but God used those people to bring about a repentance in my life. Yes, sir?
Yeah, maybe got saved because a Sunday school teacher came and visited him at work and talked to him about spiritual things.
I know a pastor right now that's God has saved him through a bus ministry. And because of that bus ministry, somebody come and knocked on his door, got him to come to church, he got saved. And then from there, and now he's a pastor, he's seeing people saved, Jewish people too. He has a Jewish ministry. So, you never know. But, we need to be thankful that sometime in the past, God used somebody who was in that path. And then that the ability that, now I don't want to say use the word ability, but then that God, in his sovereignty, directed us and put us in places where we could be taught the doctrines, where we could be in a place that the ground was fertile and we could grow in Christ. As ye have been taught. And he tells us this at the end, therein with thanksgiving. We need to be thankful. I think a lot of times we're not thankful enough. The idea here, if you read the words, it says abounding therein with thanksgiving. The idea is to be overflowing exceedingly with thanksgiving. Do you appreciate what God has given you, not only in salvation, but the moment you were saved, he gave you spiritual gifts to use in the church, to be able to minister to others, to be a blessing in the church, and to really minister to individuals, some lost, some saved, needing that. I was trying to think of the word, they used the balm of Gilead or something, just that nurturing aspect in there. None of us brought the word of God to ourselves, but God brought it to us. And praise the Lord for that. And anything we do is God using us for his glory. We need to appreciate that. We need to be thankful. He provided his word. He has protected his word and guarded the truth about himself, about his love, and what was needed for us to please him with our life. We know all this because of the word of God and what he's done for us. But do we truly appreciate all he's given us? Now, I'm sure everybody said yes in their heart. So I think the answer to that question lies in two other questions. Is it your desire to be in the house of God every time the door is open? And the second one is, are you preparing the soil of your heart for growth? Now, if you weren't here, you probably missed all that about the soil and stuff. I was Farmer Browning in a little while. But anyway, we'll leave that there. And let's go on to verse 8. It says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. To me, I see a comparison here. Not really a comparison, but he's trying to show you the contradiction. What you have in Christ and what you have in men that are spoiling you. If the individual in Christ is not preparing their heart, that soil for the seed, the word of God to have a place to germinate and grow, they are and have opened themselves up to the world. In 8 it says, beware. Beware. Be careful about what's going on. It's Colossians 2, 8. What does beware mean? Anybody else? Yes, sir?
Be alert.
Be alert. Yes, sir?
Wary.
Wary. Say yours again. Let me just say what I have written. I looked this up. It actually all fits together. Yes, sir?
Be careful.
It all fits together. But there's a key in this, and I'll explain. Beware is to be able to discern, to be able to see, to have the power of seeing. The idea is being able to perceive. So if you're going to be wary, you're going to be careful. All the words you used, you don't know there's danger unless you can see it. Have you ever walked through the woods and run across a rattlesnake? I have. You can hear it, but sometimes it takes an awful lot to find it, because they match right in. There's all sorts of things in this world we need to be aware of, and they match right in. You go into certain churches, and the churches look good. They look godly. But you better beware, because God may not be there. There's certain things you got to look for. You are the preaching and teaching the word of God. Does the music honor God? You understand what I'm saying? You need to be careful. You need to be able to discern between good and bad. You need to be able to discern between the holy and the unholy. Because if you can't, how can you protect yourself? How can you beware if you don't know what the danger looks like? So there's you're all right, but you had to get to that step. You have to be able to discern that danger. You know, Some people, when you talk with them, oh man, if you were to talk with them, they're like, wow. I remember there was this boy I worked with one time, just for a short period. I was the new man on the job. And he talked so good. I mean, he was really a likable fellow. And one of the other workers come at me and says, you better watch him. I said, what do you mean? He says, he's getting in your pockets just as quick as he can. I was like, well, he's mistaken because I don't loan money. You know, but in other words, all this was to put up and form a relationship to soften the target. And I was like, well, you know, that's out there today. We have a lot of things out there. We have people who claim to be preachers and teachers that are not preachers and teachers of God. So you need to be careful. So it's the idea of being able to perceive. We have a need as God's children to have the power of understanding and discernment. Pastor Stevens once said, and I remember this very, very vividly, he says, inevitably, when he's talking with people, he said, and they get around talking about discernment, he said, certain people have told him, and I have great discernment. He says, and it never fails. Everyone that's told him that has had no discernment. I guess we all think we have discernment. Don't tell me. No. Let's just let it go at that. But if you don't possess that power of understanding, that power of discernment, I question whether you're walking with God, whether you're walking in the Spirit, whether you surrender to Him, and why. Why do I say that? I see an elbow up, but not a hand. Nobody knows?
If you're surrendered to Him, He will guide you.
You can be swayed very easily if you want to preach.
Where does discernment come from?
It should come from God's Word.
It comes from the Holy Spirit. If you want to see the difference between good and evil, you get closer to God. You know, the further we are from God, the less dangers we'll see in our life, because the less discernment we have. But the closer we get to Him, the more we're walking in tune with Him, the more He can reveal to us. Because our hearts are right. We're surrendered. We're walking with Him. And so He can show us. He can reveal that. But if you're not walking with God, you're walking after the flesh. I mean, you say, well, there's this little gray area. I'm not really walking with God, but I'm not really walking after the flesh. Well, we have a very good word to describe that little gray area down south. It's called baloney. If you're not walking with God, you're walking in the flesh. There is no in-between here. There is none. And you have to be very careful that you are walking with God, walking in the Spirit. You want that discernment. I'm going to come at this a little different way. I'm only going to make one statement, so don't worry, I'm not going to ride this horse too long. The ability to walk in the Spirit and not after the flesh, that's what He gives. You can't walk in the Spirit without Him. It's impossible. So let's go on. And it goes on to say here, it says, beware, and then it says, least any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. Least any man spoil you. God forbid that we allow ourselves to become entrapped in philosophies, or to become entrapped by the things of this world, the base things. And by the way, it's very easy. Yes, sir.
What is the meaning of spoil?
Be taken captive.
Okay.
Least any man spoil you.
There's two senses of spoil, and one is to take. If you spoil somebody as in ruining them, or spoil as in going bad, or spoiling as in taking riches or plunder.
Okay, I'm going to address that a little bit more in the next line, but that's fine. We don't want to allow ourselves to become entrapped. That's where the discernment comes in. That's where the ability that God gives us, that understanding to see things as we walk close to Him. The base things of this world. It's very easy for us to get entrapped, if you would, by the things of this world. We live in the flesh. The flesh is not redeemed. We live in a world, and the world is not a world of God. It's a world of carnality. It's a world of flesh. It's ruled by the prince of the power of the air, which is Satan. And so you understand, everything is actually oppressive to us, if you would. We're not in the age that we want to be in yet. And so we need to be careful that we don't allow ourselves to be subjugated. We should not be looking at the things of this world. We should be looking for the next world. I hope that one of the things you're looking for is the day when you will be with Christ and he will take the fruit of the vine again. We'll have the big feast. I hope that you're looking for that day. I'm not looking to be a millionaire. I'm not looking to be wealthy. You know, I'm looking for that day when I will be with him. That's my hope. You know, I'm looking forward to seeing what this new Jerusalem looks like. I want to try out my wings. No, I don't know if I'm going to have wings. But you understand, I want to be where the power of sin is no longer oppressive to me, where I'm no longer tempted. You understand what I'm saying? And so this is what we're to be looking at. Lest any man spoil you. And this any man spoil you. The idea of spoil, what he was dealing with, I told him, was to take you captive. The definition here said, keep on guard, for there are men, people who desire to carry believers off, to make them captive by leading them from the truth. You ever known Christians who eventually fall out of the church and begin to do other things, and you think they all got it figured out? They've been taken captive. I tell you what, I've got this little plan here, and if you work with me for a couple years, we'll make big money, and you can do whatever you want. You can give half of it to missions. You can tithe to the church. You can do anything you want. Listen, God would rather take a dollar a Sunday from you than have you promise him to give him all this if he'll just give you a few years. The more you're separated, and the longer you're separated, the further you'll be from him, and the harder it will be to get back. Dr. Bond always said, compromise will take you further down the road than you're willing to go, cost you more than you're willing to pay, and keep you longer than you're willing to stay. And that's a pretty good saying. Compromise has a knack for doing that. It will destroy you if you allow it to. Keep on guard. Their desire, these people, these men, their desire is to subjugate God's children with their opinions. How many people have come up to you and tried to persuade you that there is no God? That the Bible is just a book? It's just a book of stories is what I hear a lot anymore. It's just a book of stories. Don't mean anything. They're constantly telling you something. They want you to believe in their opinion. This is the age of opinion. I got one too. You're full of it. You're a bunch of baloney. Get out of here. I don't want anything to do with you. I have no time to waste on that. But the idea of being carried off captive is the idea of enslaving a person, giving them little to no power to free themselves from bondage. That's exactly what the world we want to do. That's what this world is all about, is looking to bind you up. Now, when we talk about enslaving a person, we're talking about, and there's been some interesting stories in the news over the past couple years, people who've been kidnapped and chained for 5, 7, 10 years. Unbelievable amount of time. Some of them longer than that. Some of them were taken as little kids. They've grown up. They've had little kids now that have grown up. And they were captives. You would thought that would be impossible. They were written off as dead. But they were captive for years. So when we look at that, we think of by force. But not all captives are taken by force. How was Eve taken? By subtlety. You know? Oh, if you take this, you'll be like God. You know the difference between, you'll have all that knowledge, you'll know that difference, you'll be able, and he just kept painting the picture. But he took her captive because she fell for it. And then she drew others in with her. And so you understand that. It's not always by force. Sometimes it's by subtle actions. How about advertisements? You deserve more. I'm telling you, you deserve more. You are so worthy, you need to come get this car and go in debt for 10 years. You're worthy. You know? And then you have the beer commercials and the alcohol commercials. We age our liquor 20 years. You don't want that cheap stuff. You want to come and get the good stuff or the beer, you know. You don't want domestic. You want that imported stuff. It's always something. You are worthy, though. They're painting a picture. It's okay to sin. It's okay to drift from God because you're worthy. Baloney, you know. Or if you're in Brazil, cabaçal, I don't care. But it's an enticement to get you to do something you should not do. Did you have your hand up? No? Okay, I'm sorry. I saw it caught out in the corner of my eye.
Yeah, most people aren't forced. Most people who become drug addicts or alcoholics aren't forcibly given their first drink or their first drug.
It's a subtle pressure by their friends, you know. I remember them saying to others, never to me, but they had been right to say it to me. They said, you can't handle it, that's why you don't want to drink. That's a subtle pressure, you know. You just can't handle it, you know. But yeah, it's a shame, but we have that subtlety. Satan knows how to work. He knows how to get in there. Oh yeah, yeah. Nobody really is immune to it. We're human. We have that same sin nature in us. But don't worry, the advertisement says you're righteous and you can enter into debt or wicked activity because you are worthy. I'll let you know right now, that's just the work of Satan. It's how he works on us. He works on our emotions, he works on pride, he works on anger. He'll work in any way he can to get in there. He'll discourage you, whatever it takes to break you and get you to go down the path he wants you to go. In our churches, people come in. They act like they're part of us, but they're not of us. But they act like they're part of us. And the truth is, there are a lot of people out there that won't fellowship, and they'll come in, and they seem harmless enough. But let me just be flat out. There's much to fear about people that come into the church and won't join. You know, why are they here? What are they doing? In the Ukraine, and it was in Covell. I've told you before, they sent in church breakers. They come in, they act like the rest of the Christians. They got involved, they made friends and everything. And then all of a sudden, well, you know what? I don't like that preacher. And they start throwing out false accusations. They broke the church. Split it wide open. Destroyed it. That church was just beginning and had started a Bible college where they trained young Ukrainians to plant churches. God was beginning to use that church. And they sent them in. Let me tell you something. I've told you before, the wolves are at the door. There's always somebody looking in here to destroy what we're building. And the only way it's not going to happen, if we keep our hearts right and we walk, because then we'll be able to identify the problems. We'll see it. But there is much fear in that. I always wonder, I said, how many people in Canada, in the States, actually come into the churches to break it? You know, I don't know. You know, but I often wonder about that. How many people come in to change the church? You know, you are a nation that grows by immigration. You know, you have people that come in and they want to bring their country and their cultures here. They don't want to adapt in. They don't want to become a part. So what does that make you? What does it make you? Divided. Exactly. And the more you're divided, the weaker you get. And so you do want to become one together. It's one of the reasons I say, remember, we didn't come to join you. You come to join us. We want them to be a part. We want them in the church to become a part of our church. Anyway, so we are warned to be careful not to allow these people. It says here, he says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. What's philosophy? Philosophy is a systematic study of general and fundamental questions concerning topics like existence, reason, knowledge, maybe things about value or mind and language. It's pretty rational, and it's a critical inquiry. They will reflect upon themselves. That's philosophy. You got to be careful with that. The Bible says that knowledge puffeth up. We begin to... Yes, sir.
Pastor Harry needs to say, philosophy is a man looking for a black cat in a dark room that's not there.
I keep thinking of philosophy when they're talking about these questions and things. I think about, in my own mind, it's people make that a type of religion to justify their actions and stuff. They don't want to go back to the Word of God and see what God says. They want to come up with their own opinions, and that's what rules them. They would rather depend on human reasoning than God's Word. That's a very, very deceptive practice. It's vain. It's empty. Your human reasoning will not take you to heaven. Your human reasoning will not justify you before God. Religion is human reasoning. Human reasoning, I mean, religion is like, okay, we're going to do 50 Hail Marys. I'm going to baptize your face first, hold you down for 3 months. Whatever it is, you dream it up. But it's what we say that makes us look good to God and each other. We've dreamed this thing up. We've got to have a certain look. We've got to have a certain talk. We got to have everything just right. And I'm not saying you can run around and say anything. There's holy and unholy language. There's holy and unholy actions. But what I'm saying, if you're depending on those things to get you to heaven, you're sadly mistaken. Because you can do all those things, and if you don't have Christ in your heart, the indwelling spirit, you'll die and go to hell. That system is not what saves you. And that's what they believe. Well, we can do this. We can make ourselves grand before God. We can make ourselves holy. No. The Bible has the answers, but they'd still rather depend on their own reasoning. Yes, sir.
Well, I was thinking philosophy being like, by definition, the love of wisdom.
But right.
I think of Solomon in the Proverbs saying, get wisdom.
Yeah.
Because here it says, vain deceit at the tradition of men. So that's like a worldly philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when I was coming out of high school, I kind of wanted to study the classics and philosophy, and I didn't really know what it was. And I know some of the names, like a guy like Bertrand Russell. But he was definitely an antichrist type of philosopher. But there's another one, I can't think of who he was right now, who was actually a godly type. So maybe, you know, so it's a pretty abstract term, but I mean, I'm sure there's some philosophers that were godly.
Well, I would say this to differentiate. I understand what you're saying about the philosophy they taught, but I don't call the Word of God philosophy. And the word you come up with, wisdom, I will agree. There's a wisdom of God and there's a wisdom of men. Philosophy would be the wisdom of men. And Solomon said, if you're going to get wisdom, and he personified it. And how do you get wisdom? You get wisdom from God. If any man lacketh wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. So we know that there's a godly wisdom. And we know that if we seek God, and we will seek after that and ask him, he'll give it to us.
Fear of the Lord is the beginning.
Sure. There's a lot of verses talking about wisdom, but philosophy, I don't think I can think of any that would be anything that God would equate back to himself in the Word of God. He equates it back to men because he's equating them and their willingness to not accept his path and his way, and it's my way. How many people say, well, I got this figured out. I'm all set. I got it. Well, there's a lot of people say that. A lot of people. And the truth is they're not set unless they're set on Christ. Yes, sir.
His ways are higher than our ways.
Amen. Amen. And you have to remember now, God is all knowledge. You remember what it said? We were just in that. In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge? In whom? In Christ. All are hid. All right, I'm going to stop right here. I'm not going to drag out. I keep going over, so I'm trying not to go over. All right. So, all right. We'll stop right there.